Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fiber, the Coming Tech Revolution, and Why America Might Miss It, by Susan Crawford. Read by Coleen Marlo. Chapter 1. The Fiber Future. Here is the tech revolution America may miss. On a gray, cloudy weekday morning in August, I drove across the wide Han River that divides the northern and southern parts of Seoul. I turned east onto a furiously busy highway that runs alongside the river. I was noticing everything at once. The enormous pale forests of concrete apartment blocks, each forest pointed in a seemingly random direction, each building labeled with a number. The traffic, and the Lotte Group Tower ahead of me, the tallest building in South Korea, narrowing to bat-like ears at its top. It had been the CEO's dream to build the tallest tower in the country. But the structure is roundly disliked, and sinkholes have started opening at its base. The traffic in Seoul is crushing and constant, an oppressive fact of life for the 10 million impatient citizens of that booming metropolis. After a few minutes, a huge concrete stadium with fading Olympic rings decorating its side came into view. This was the Seoul Olympic Stadium, built for the 1988 Summer Olympics, but not used for a major world sporting event since then. I drove on, and the forests of apartment towers and the crushing traffic continued for another 20 minutes, but then fell away, and I was in the suburbs and heading toward the mountains. I had been on many journeys over the previous 5 years, interviewing hundreds of people in Stockholm, Seoul, Tokyo, Singapore, Berlin, Amsterdam, Copenhagen, and Havana, as well as in a long list of U.S. cities, about the possible effects on human lives of virtually unlimited, cheap, ubiquitous communications capacity. This was my third trip to Seoul. I had come to see what South Korea, the most wired nation on the planet, would show the world when it hosted the 2018 Winter Olympics, 6 months away. My destination that morning was a rural, hilly area 3 hours east of Seoul, about 95 miles away, a small town of some 30,000 people called Pyeongchang. There was no way to get there other than by driving. Although a high-speed rail link between Seoul and Pyeongchang was being built that would make a one-hour trip possible, the line hadn't been completed. No one knew how expensive the rail tickets would be, and these calculations mattered. There weren't enough hotel rooms in Pyeongchang for the anticipated 75,000 fans, even though buildings to house visitors were hastily being thrown up near the event venues, and older structures were being pressed into new roles as hotels. Many Olympics enthusiasts would have to make a daily round trip by train from Seoul, a gigantic place with 30,000 hotel rooms. There is no housing to speak of between Seoul and Pyeongchang, and the Pyeongchang Olympic Hockey Center and Ice Arena can hold up to 22,000 spectators. And so I found myself driving east of Seoul on a brand new four-lane freeway, specially built for the upcoming Olympics. I checked my phone. My 4G coverage throughout the three-hour trip was spectacular. The ice track ahead of you slopes steeply down and curves sharply to the right and out of view. And then you're off, at unimaginably high speed, slamming into the banks of the track and zipping forcibly around every curve, while you keep an eye on the stopwatch and the heart rate indicator projected on the top right corner of your view. You are seeing and hearing a bobsled run. Your stomach is convinced you yourself are hunkered down in the body of the streamlined bobsled, from the perspective of your favorite athlete, a young man from Seoul who is a luge prodigy, and hopes with his team to snag the gold medal for his country. Seconds later, you're in the virtual company of your friends, chatting away. They're all around you. The bobsled, meanwhile, is taking an alarming turn, high up on the side of the track, to gain crucial momentum for the end of the run, and you and your buddies, sitting in your living rooms or standing on street corners, have been granted your favorite athlete's point of view and insight into his climbing heart rate. You collectively hold your breath. Will he win? Later that day, you visit the ice arena to see the high-pressure couples' ice dancing competition. You are still in your living room in Seoul, but it doesn't feel like it. You can see every corner of the arena from any one of 100 cameras. Your view moving easily around the enormous building with its sky blue seats and bright digital displays. As your attention wanders to the VIP boxes, you miss a crucial dance moment. The roar of the crowd brings you back and you quickly speak, asking for a replay. The replay you are instantly shown allows you to see the ice dancer's perfectly choreographed jump and to freeze the image, leaving both dancers above the ice, graceful and eternal. You move the skaters backward and forward a few times to see how they got to that height, before smoothly, slowly, allowing them to continue their flawless joint routine. You marvel at their skill, and the image you see is so detailed and seems so real that you feel you could touch the woman's silk sleeve and feel the thinness of the fabric. That evening, the visitors to the events who have made the physical trek out to the Olympic venues, not you because you are still at home in your living room in Seoul, ride around the city in an aquamarine bus. On the side of the bus, bold white letters read, "World's first 5G connected car." The Olympic visitors touch the windows of the bus and write with their fingers, interacting with displays showing them live coverage of the Olympic events around them. A man with a long white cane suddenly walks right in front of the bus. The bus has no driver. The riders realize the pedestrian is blind and feel powerless to do anything about the collision that is about to happen. But the bus, guided by tsunamis of data running over 5G networks, smoothly rolls around him, avoiding an accident. The riders turn back to bantering with their personalized window displays, sometimes the face of a guide, sometimes a map, sometimes text, whatever they're interested in. And when they go inside the physical arenas, their smartphones speak softly to them about where they are in relation to their ticketed seats and where snacks are being sold. Late at night, stirred by the bravery and heart of the athletes you've seen and whose perspectives you've shared, you walk around Seoul. You're interested in knowing more about your favorite athlete. You want to hear from him about his childhood dreams, and Seoul is having a special digital event in his honor. Wearing glasses that allow you to see digital overlays on physical objects, you are fascinated by the stories told by the buildings that were part of the athlete's past. You're touched by the connections to your own life and delighted by the digital scenarios and jokes your favorite athlete has left for you to enjoy. Welcome to the future, the first hints of which were visible at the Winter Olympics of February 2018 in Pyeongchang. Korea Telecom, KT, unveiled its very high-capacity but very short-range 5G wireless communications network, at least 10 times faster than 4G, to the world during those games, so South Koreans really could be part of speed skating or ski jumping events from the perspectives of the athletes involved, and ride autonomous buses on an 88-acre test site, the world's biggest. It was a major collaboration. The enormous South Korean company Samsung and Hyundai, together with Intel and Ericsson, committed to the enterprise and built hardware to handle the flood of data moving around the Olympic venues before a global standard for 5G communications, not expected until 2020, even existed. South Korea simply wanted to be first. And South Koreans with 5G-enabled devices were the most engaged sports fans on the planet during those Olympics. They could see and hear anything they chose in real time from any angle, including the athlete's view, while surrounded by their friends and other South Koreans as fellow commentators. Interactive holographic projections, along with augmented reality, the digital overlay made possible with glasses or smartphones or interactive bus windows, allowed for new forms of engagement. KT's 360 virtual reality technology made viewers feel as if they were right there in the stadium, no matter where they actually were. And its time-slice technology allowed watchers to roll these visuals back and forth at will. The Seoul traffic, the distance, and the lack of hotel rooms were less of an issue, as was the incomplete state of the Seoul-Pyeongchang high-speed rail link. Except for the self-driving bus, which has to be physically experienced, anyone in Seoul with a 5G-enabled handset could have a real-time experience of the Olympic Games that was much the same as what those actually present had, minus the crowds. What makes these astonishing feats of communications transport possible? Floods of data flowing back and forth from an athlete to millions of fans and back, without an instant of hesitation, is South Korea's extensive fiber-optic network. The country is wired with 375,000 miles of fiber-optic cables, formed of hair-thin filaments of unbelievably pure synthetic glass, which channel light across the many miles between rural Pyeongchang and homes and businesses in the rest of the country. Son Jin-oh, the cheerful, bespectacled director general of the Technology Bureau for the Pyeongchang Organizing Committee for the 2018 Olympic Games, told me that fiber serves as a basic infrastructure for telecommunication services in Korea. To beef up the fiber capacity in rural Pyeongchang and the nearby coastal town of Gyeongyong, Korea Telecom added thousands of additional fiber strands in the area. All the TV cameras broadcasting the Olympics had direct fiber connections that allowed them to integrate and upload data simultaneously. KT did the same at thousands of other physical locations, providing sensors to which data was sent across very short distances over the air using KT's 5G wireless network. Think tiny, tiny cell towers receiving and sending a ton of data for short distances. Without fiber optic lines connected to those tiny cell towers, 5G doesn't work. South Korea has this amazing fiber optic connectivity because years ago its government, still rising from the rubble of the Korean War and urged on by the giant electronics conglomerate Samsung, decided that world-class data networks would be key to the future success of the country. KT and other telecom companies were urged, through a combination of subsidies, tax breaks, and low-cost loans, to upgrade to fiber-optic connections. In his Next Generation Connectivity Report from 2010, my colleague, Yo-Chai Benkler, wrote that South Korea had invested $24 billion in its first transition on connecting schools and government centers in the 1990s, over $70 billion in low-cost loans to providers, and over $12 billion per year from 2004 to 2007 on its transition to the next-generation ubiquitous fiber network. He noted that it was unclear who exactly spent the money, public authorities or private companies. But the results have been dazzling. South Koreans take virtually unlimited, cheap connectivity, both uploads, performing, and downloads, consuming, for granted. And the country is now poised to have advanced wireless services that are possible only because fiber optic cables run to just about every home and business in the country. As Mr. Oh solemnly told me the day I visited, in August 2017, through the Olympics, we are preparing thoroughly to show to the world what cutting-edge telecommunications services we have in Korea. In the United States, we have fiber-optic cables between cities called long-haul or backbone lines, and within any metro area of significant size, there are middle-mile or business data services fiber-optic lines. These cables often connect to telephone poles or other network elements, but don't go all the way to retail customers' premises. What Korea, Japan, Hong Kong, China, Singapore, and the Nordic countries have that the rest of the world does not are fiber-optic cables running physically, directly into neighborhoods, homes, and businesses in both rural and urban areas, the so-called last-mile network. Inventors have found ways to encode stunning amounts of information on pulses of light vibrating billions of times a second, and then send that light on its journey through a channel made of the purest glass on Earth. If the information-carrying capacity of copper wire is like a 2-inch-wide pipe, fiber optic is like a river 15 miles wide. You wouldn't even try to download a 4K movie using a copper connection, but using fiber, you could download 10 movies in a second, or run your own business remotely, or see your doctor or members of your family when needed, as needed. Most of the phone calls going on throughout the world at any moment could be carried simultaneously across a single hair-thin strand of fiber. But because people send and receive information from where they physically are, Fiber-optic cables need to be physically distributed to reach individual buildings in order for fiber's capacity across all the parts of the network, middle mile, long haul, and undersea cables linking continents, to be fully harnessed. In many developed countries, that last mile is the weakest link in the network. Its materials, copper or coaxial cable, serving to throttle communications just as they are starting on their journeys from individuals to the rest of the world, and slowing incoming data just as it is about to arrive in those individuals' lives. Once the fiber cable reaches an individual living unit, that is, a home, data can be sent over the air to devices we wear or hold in our hands. The plan is for 5G wireless to allow for the sending of enormous amounts of data over the air across very short distances, to reach humans, handsets, sensors, or anything else capable of receiving or transmitting data. Because the last mile has to connect to individual buildings, it is also the most expensive part of any communications network to install. Most of that expense, perhaps 80% of it, is the high fixed costs of the labor needed to dig up streets or attach fiber optic wire to poles and buildings. And revenue will not flow in to cover those costs until the last mile is actually in use. Just like electricity or water service, last mile communications networks are often called a natural monopoly. Those high fixed installation costs mean that it simply does not make economic sense for two separate fiber cables to be attached to any given location. To avoid allowing the resulting natural monopoly position to be used to extract unreasonably high fees from subscribers, telecommunications regulators often require that the basic communications line be made available on a wholesale, price-controlled basis to competing retail providers. Back to the 2018 Olympics. The fiber optic lines very close to the locations where Olympic athletes in Pyeongchang wore cameras and microphones allowed them to beam information about their experiences across the airwaves by way of 5G connections to the installed fiber. Fiber can carry a virtually unlimited amount of data at the speed of light, so all those cameras and tiny cell towers surrounding the athletes and self-driving buses picked up on their movements and perceptions, were able to spew data to their heart's content. All of that local last-mile fiber in Pyeongchang and Gangneung is connected to the existing intercity fiber optic lines running to Seoul and elsewhere in South Korea. Think highway system with interstate freeways acting as long-haul networks, local highways acting as middle-mile connections, and residential roads and driveways playing the role of the last mile. That final segment, made up of those last-mile fiber connections, is what allowed everyone in any South Korean living room with a 5G handset to be present at the Olympics, with virtually zero delay between an athlete's gesture in Pyeongchang and the perception of that gesture 95 miles away in Seoul. Latency, a word used for delay, has been reduced to about 1 millisecond across this connection. Humans love zero latency. We are genuinely bugged by delay between our touch of a key and the reaction of a remote computer hundreds of miles away to that touch, just as we are put off by delay in human interactions. In the United States, we cannot even imagine cheap, unlimited communications capacity in our homes. Because of decades of political maneuvering by the enormous private companies that sell internet access to American consumers, a lack of leadership at the federal level, and the invisibility of this entire policy area, we have failed to make the upgrade to cheap last-mile fiber connectivity. We suffer from a whole series of digital divides as a country. On the global stage, there is a deep and widening divide between the United States on the one hand and Japan, South Korea, Singapore, Hong Kong, and China on the other. Those places, where fiber now reaches or soon will reach all residents, are where new industries and new ways of making a living are likely to emerge first. We also suffer from huge digital divides between richer and poorer Americans that will make inequality worse and weaken the fabric of democracy. These infrastructure divides are driving wedges between rural and urban Americans and between white and non-white Americans. all the policies important to us as a country, becoming the most advanced healthcare nation in the world, the most energy efficient, the most innovative, the most resilient, depend on having last-mile fiber and advanced wireless services available cheaply to everyone. We must do better. Fiber optic as a category is both old and new. The cables running under the oceans and among the major cities of the world began to be upgraded to fiber 30 years ago. And once a fiber optic cable is in the ground, it lasts for 40 or 50 years. It is essentially future-proof, because its information-carrying capacity can be almost infinitely upgraded without digging up the cable, merely by swapping out the electronics that encode and power the pulses of light that travel within its walls. Most people in non-fiber countries, including the United States, can't even buy what in fibered countries counts as a standard modern internet connection. About 11 million American households, out of 126 million total, are connected to last-mile fiber, and that service is usually available only at very high prices from a single unregulated provider. Meanwhile, South Korea, Japan, Hong Kong, and Singapore have virtually 100% fiber adoption at low prices and often scores of competitors. This is a big problem. Here's why. Those hair-thin fiber strands, capable of carrying billions of phone calls simultaneously, plus advanced wireless communications that depend on that fiber extending into the last mile, will make possible virtually unlimited cheap communications capacity wherever you are, which in turn will give rise to new businesses, new transport capabilities, new ways of managing our use of energy, new forms of education and healthcare, new ways of earning a living, and new forms of human connectedness. For these things to happen, both fiber and advanced wireless technologies need to be widely and competitively available. Without these basic pieces of open infrastructure in place, your country will be missing out on the future being lived and built elsewhere. Much of the world gets this. China is installing 20,000 last-mile fiber optic connections every single day. In June 2017, the South China Morning Post reported, China set to build the planet's largest 5G mobile network for $180 billion U.S. dollars. Listen to that, the planet's largest. Fiber plus advanced wireless capability is essential to the next phase of human existence as electricity was 100 years ago. Just as countries that quickly ensured cheap access to electricity revolutionized their economies and provided dramatically improved quality of life for their citizens, countries that figure out how to get fiber to everyone will have ever-increasing advantages over those that do it slowly. Take the 2018 Olympics in South Korea. Korea Telecom was smart to focus on sports, and the Olympics in particular, in demonstrating its prowess. Sports grab humans in real-time emotional ways, and the Olympics marked the global pinnacle of inspiring athletic achievement. KT got the world's attention in 2018. But KT's display of its 5G fireworks is far more significant than any Olympic event could possibly be. Korea is going through a phase change in digital communications that has implications for almost every occupation and source of economic power of which we're aware today. In the crowded city of Seoul, for example, I met many 20-somethings who did not distinguish between online life and real life. For them, these are simply layers of life as a whole. This generation is so accustomed to cheap, unlimited connectivity everywhere that they have forgotten its existence, just as people in other countries forget the existence of electricity until it is suddenly not there. South Koreans are impatient. For them, going to almost any city in the United States is a little like going off the grid. In Seoul, I met Young Song Choi, a professional e-sports player who is as famous in his sport as Lionel Messi, the best goal scorer in the world, is in soccer. Young Song, who now works as a coach for the SK Telecom T1 StarCraft II team. Telecommunications companies are major investors in the e-sports industry in Korea. told me he'd lived through the transformation of Korea that took place following the installation of high-capacity networks that permitted any number of people to play games simultaneously. At age 20, he realized he could beat just about anyone. The essential factor in connectivity, he says, is latency, or response time. Any delay makes it very difficult to play. Some players say latency starts to become obvious when there is a gap of 150 milliseconds or even less between pressing a button and a visual response. Fiber connections generally have lower latency than cable or copper wires. In Korea, the response time is really short, he said, laughing. He sees a bright future for the gaming industry in Korea, but there is much more than gaming. The same technology will revolutionize business, medicine, education, manufacturing, energy use, and real-time translation functions between spoken languages. Fiber is also revolutionizing cities themselves. Because the city of Seoul years ago installed fiber-optic last-mile connections throughout the city and its subway system, it can provide free Wi-Fi, which means the private sector can experiment with Internet of Things, IoT services, that will improve its citizens' lives. On the same trip that had me clamoring around the empty ice arena in Pyeongchang, I visited the city's IoT testbed office. Taejin Kim, director of the testbed, told me that the city is testing its ability to provide personalized services to elders, to provide data from road surfaces and public transit so that navigation systems function well, and in general, to solve urban problems wherever they are. The conference room next to the mayor's office houses an enormous dashboard that, fed by public data, allows the mayor to see the site of an accident or fire, talk in real time to public officials at the site, visually understand traffic congestion, and manage the city's budget. Because fiber is everywhere, this enormous amount of data can be shipped whenever and wherever it is needed. The next wave of applications making use of fiber and advanced wireless services is likely to be in healthcare, education, or other fundamental areas that has been seen so far in Korea and Japan. I am confident that innovative American businesses will come up with services that use much more significant amounts of bandwidth when there is a critical mass of users with capacity. If and when the United States becomes a last-mile fiber sandbox for this inventiveness, the huge market here will drive those developments. We will also support our commitment to genuine liberal democracy, the rising tide of cheap, ubiquitous, unlimited connectivity needs to reach everyone in order for the country as a whole to thrive. This same virtuous cycle of innovation happened with electricity more than 100 years ago. In 1907, when just a small part of life in the United States had been electrified, mostly street lamps and streetcars, appliance makers had little incentive to manufacture mass-market devices that used electricity, because the adoption of domestic electricity was minimal. During the 1920s, America's private utilities were focused on the enormous profits to be made in industrial electrical modernization. Not until the Great Depression weakened that industrial sector did they pivot toward domestic electricity. It was hard at the time to imagine why vast amounts of electricity would be needed in daily life. Some houses were wired for lighting, but not for general electricity use, and appliances initially were plugged into light bulb sockets. Wall switches at an entrance were considered a luxury. Nonetheless, according to David Nye in his 1990 book, Electrifying America, the introduction of electric lights in the homes of the very wealthy was an entering wedge into home use of electricity, prompting appliance makers to think of other devices that could be plugged into the network, which eventually, in turn, motivated mass electrification. Manufacturers introduced electric irons, toasters, vacuum cleaners, electric washers, hot plates, and many other labor-saving devices. The electric fan was a big success. Electricity use soared, creating a need for additional capacity and the business case for building it. Electrical apps proved not only that usage would justify further build-out, but that a model based on affordability and mass consumption was feasible. This app-based wisdom prompted federal investment in projects like a traveling exhibition of farm equipment in rural areas, a sort of agricultural circus that reached about 1 million farmers in 26 states between 1939 and 1941, and the provision of financing options for appliances. The federal effort was not limited to rural areas. The Roosevelt administration expanded consumer credit to low-income houses to advance electrical modernization. With no down payment, homeowners could buy a refrigerator using low-interest loans for as little as $3 a month, thus bringing refrigeration, the essential ingredient of a modern kitchen, into the lives of millions. The private utilities had thought of their market as consisting only of one-fifth of American households that were already modernized. But the use of electricity ballooned. Where the average early 1920s household had been using 30 kilowatt hours or less each month, by 1950, most households had modern electrical services and were using more than 150 kilowatt hours monthly. The secret to mass electrification was twofold: lower the price of electricity and get more appliances out to more people by whatever means possible. Electricity became normal and invisible. Today, when we do not yet have effective distribution of last-mile fiber capacity at competitive prices to a giant marketplace of users, the next killer apps are just emerging. One thing we know, however, is that humans have never preferred less connectivity at higher prices. Imagine being able to make eye contact with your doctor, even though there's 1,000 miles between you, to be seen and understood as clearly and as fully as if you were in the room with her. Imagine being in touch with distant relatives and feeling part of their lives, even if you're in a different country. Imagine being present in a classroom, not just downloading files or watching a lecture, but participating fully, speaking up from wherever you are. Imagine the implications for advanced research of being able to upload, download, visualize, and stream huge data files without thinking twice about the capacity of the networks you're using. Imagine a city that can pull together, analyze, and understand all the data being collected by its transportation, water, and energy networks. Imagine technical directions being conveyed by way of augmented reality, so that you can be an apprentice in a remote factory rather than traveling to a physical central training location. Imagine being over 80 and able to live a dignified, socially connected life while staying in your home, connected to far-flung relatives and able easily to summon people who care about you to your side. Imagine having eye contact with anyone, anywhere, and communicating the empathy and concern that humans need to thrive. Somewhere in our evolution, socializing and connecting with each other became a species characteristic, and fiber will allow us to be present in others' lives in ways we cannot now imagine. By permitting genuine eye contact at a distance, and the empathy and connection that contact can bring, high bandwidth, no delay fiber connections could make the experience of online connection much more like physical presence. Real eye contact, so far, has been impossible over existing copper wire and cable lines. Too little information is flowing symmetrically to make this kind of presence possible. Over the past 5 years, I have been learning from people around the world what they have found useful about last-mile fiber networks. I've traveled to American cities to meet the pioneers who are struggling to install them here in the United States. I met many 20-somethings in Seoul and Tokyo who talked to me candidly about the transformation of their friendships and way of life in their busy cities. Things just work here, I was told over and over again. Transit tickets and schedules are entirely electronic. Cash is never used in Seoul, and robots guide you through the airport. In Stockholm, the mayor volunteered to help me persuade American government leaders that fiber last-mile networks are essential to modern life. In Nashville, Tennessee, a leader of fiber installations in Asia told me, quite seriously, that America's lack of decent connectivity amounted to child abuse. In his view, we were systematically relegating our children to lives of insufficient opportunity to find meaning and dignity. Outside a noisy restaurant in Lund, Sweden, I met the man who has been labeled the Swedish broadband Jesus, Jonas Birgersson. He was wearing a tall black motorcycle helmet with the visor tilted up, making him look a bit like a welder in a science fiction movie. After we sat down, he told me that he and fellow students in Lund had showed his country the way in last-mile fiber, installing their own 100 megabits per second MBPS network in the early 1990s that connected to the basements of apartment buildings. Birshan, who was then a 20-year-old busy starting online companies, became an agitator for fiber. Along the way, he gathered several home truths. Fiber, he told me, is like a window. Whatever you send, there will be no barrier. For him, its importance was not about speed per se, but about not having to wait for your computer to do something. If you want to get things done and then move on to the next thing, you need fiber, he said. Don't think about gigabit access. Think about time. If you enjoy sitting watching the colorful wheel turn, then cable is for you. Today, more than 70% of Swedish residences have last-mile fiber-to-the-home connections. I met a young Cuban woman on the porch of the Norwegian embassy in Havana who first experienced internet access when she left the island on a scholarship and was heartbroken when she returned by the realization that nothing of the kind is likely to come to her country for a long time. I will never forget Yaima Pardo crying in front of me. She felt that Cuba was missing something crucial that the rest of the world took for granted. For her, internet access was not a matter of technology. It had become elemental, like water or fire. And Cuba had been left out, a child alone in a trackless forest, without a helping hand. She had made a documentary about the issue called Offline and had shown it around the country. At each screening, local state security officials monitored the crowds. At one of the showings, an older man came up to her afterward and thanked her. And then he said, "The internet, to me, is like death. I've heard about it, but I've never experienced it." When it comes to high-capacity access, Cuba is to the United States as the United States is to Korea. When journalist Robert Caro moved to a house on the edge of Hill Country, 50 miles outside Austin, Texas, to interview people for his biography of Lyndon Baines Johnson, he heard one phrase repeated over and over again. He brought the lights. No matter what Lyndon was like, we loved him because he brought the lights. They meant that when Johnson, from the Hill Country, became a congressman in 1937, at the age of 28, there was no electricity. But by 1948, when he was elected to the Senate, most of the district had electricity. The people of the Hill Country were so grateful they named their children after him. Before electricity, the women there had rounded shoulders from lifting heavy buckets of water, moving innumerable loads of wet clothes by broomstick between a washboard and a vat of boiling water, and working with hot irons in oven-hot summer kitchens. Caro called all of this brutal drudgery and called LBJ's ingenuity in bringing electricity to his district one of the most dramatic and noble examples of the use of government that I have ever heard. For Caro, this story is the seeds of the Great Society and the young Lyndon Johnson. We are walking the same path today with last-mile fiber-optic networks. Almost every American is like the people of the Hill Country. We suffer from totally inadequate, horribly expensive connectivity that cuts whole populations off from opportunity, adequate health care and a decent education, and thwarts the development of new businesses. A handful of private companies dominate last-mile data delivery in American cities. They choose the richest, densest areas to serve with expensive second-class services, not with malign intention, but with a detrimental effect on the country. Hundreds of American cities, fed up or ignored, have decided to call for the construction of their own last-mile fiber networks. But it's not easy. The incumbents go after them systematically, hiring academics and experts to attack these city planners as socialistic and mounting epic campaigns in state legislatures to block cities with legislation. Meanwhile, rural areas are unconnected and out of touch. The only thing we are missing is widespread public recognition of the depth and significance of the last-mile fiber problem, and either a young LBJ or a more seasoned FDR to address it. At the same time, we routinely underestimate the long-term impact of any new fundamental technology. and I suspect any guesses of mine about the effects of fiber will similarly fall short. We are already seeing dramatic improvements in agricultural productivity that have been driven by fiber to the farm, detailed automated treatment of land that is possible only with the aggregation of enormous amounts of data. Fiber and advanced wireless capacity will allow us to manage our use of energy and incorporate renewable sources into local and national power grids. The fiber story in Chattanooga, Tennessee, began with its smart grid and the cost savings of monitoring and moderating the city's use of power at very fine-grained levels, paid for its last-mile fiber installation. With a large enough consumer market, we could see vastly expanded retail opportunities that allow sellers and buyers to touch and feel goods from a distance, something we can't now do online. With fiber, you can work where you live, rather than the other way around. You can be in the office in every way short of smelling the new paint on the wall. Effective real-time business meetings drawing on expertise from widely dispersed geographic locations can actually happen on an end-to-end fiber network. New forms of collaboration among musicians and other artists will emerge over fiber. We cannot be the most advanced healthcare nation in the world without fiber everywhere, permitting Americans to avoid costly, unnecessary visits to hospitals and clinics. Advanced forms of transportation, driverless buses, personalized demand-driven subways that are better for the environment, require less human intervention, and are better suited to their context will be created. New forms of virtual reality entertainment will become part of our lives. You have to experience this to understand why it is so important. Augmented reality applications, mixing digital and real events and objects that allow us to see and understand everything around us far more deeply, will become standard. Everything I have suggested here, and much more that we cannot imagine, will become possible in countries where last-mile open-access fiber can be easily connected to competitive 5G wireless communications. These developments will also cause enormous disruption to existing occupations, and only the countries that are thinking ahead about the new industries made possible by these technologies will have the wherewithal to manage the dislocation of their labor forces, to smooth the runway to new sources of economic growth and human thriving. It's going to be amazing, but it won't happen without substantial public energy and intervention. Chapter 2. Transmitting Light. One hot July morning in Corning, New York, I opened the door of my car and gazed across the parking lot at the huge steel and glass building. I had driven alone across the entire width of the state of Massachusetts and most of New York over 2 days. In this building, I hoped, someone would be able to explain to me the magic of how fiber-optic cables are made. For me, the name Corning had meant hefty, chipped white cookware, seemingly hand-painted with a primitive looping swirl on the rims of the lids. But in the building I was looking at now, Corning had been researching high-tech glass for decades, often without a clear commercial application in view, the kind of pure science that many companies can't afford these days. The super-thin, scratch-resistant glass on the iPhone was developed by Corning scientists. And the company is not just about smartphone glass. The 9-story glass building in front of me was the home of Corning's long-term research in fiber optics. Walking around the town's historic downtown district the afternoon before, I'd found restaurants, shops, and art galleries. It's a welcoming few blocks that seems to be thriving. Corning is a small place, once a village, then a hamlet, now a town, population about 11,000, that grew up around the glassmaking industry during the 19th century. Abundant coal supplies, railroad connections, and canal links lured Brooklyn Flint Glass to Corning right after the Civil War, and the company soon changed its name to Corning Glassworks. The town attracted competitors and knock-on businesses. Glass arts flourished. But it was industrial production of glass for railroad lanterns that drove the company into profitability. And when World War I blocked the import of German glass, labware from Corning Glass became a major business. The company sponsored its own band and sports teams, and the tall glass furnaces of its main plant spewed smoke just north of downtown's Market Street, until it moved its operations outside of town. Even in June 1972, when 3 days of flooding caused by Hurricane Agnes caused disastrous, extensive damage to Corning Glassworks and to the town, the company didn't leave. Instead, it actively helped rebuild the region, and Corning was transformed from a factory town to a tourist destination, named by Rand McNally in 2013 as the most fun among the best small towns in America. The company, which changed its name to Corning Inc. in 1989, is still the largest employer in the county. The fortunes of the town of Corning have been tightly tied to those of Corning Inc. The city of Elmira, 20 miles east along the Chemung River where Mark Twain coined the term Gilded Age, hasn't rebounded from the 1972 storm. It didn't have a stabilizing corporate citizen like Corning Inc. Corning is an old town with houses meant for Corning executives perched on the top of the hill above the village. The night I arrived, one of the Corning executives had a group of his colleagues over to meet me. They were all men, and most of them were commuters. They had found it hard to convince their wives to come to the town of Corning or stay for any length of time. But first, coffee. Claudio Mazzali, a bright-eyed, energetic Brazilian physicist who has been with the company since 1999 and now leads technology efforts for two of its divisions, met me in the lobby of the research building and showed me to a large room lined by screens and gadgets. I spent many hours with Dr. Mazzali that day, and I was delighted by his wry sense of humor and somewhat goofy smile. He had first worked in Corning's Brazilian regional office as an optical communications specialist and had transferred to upstate New York about 15 years earlier. I could see that he loved his job. He's helping to run the enormous centralized research lab, the Bell Labs of our era, for a company that keeps reinventing itself as a manufacturer and annually invests about 10% of its revenue, no matter what, in research and development. Turnover at Corning is very low. Employees come for life, by and large. But Mazzali had a sense of humor about his location. We're in the middle of everything. 5 hours from New York, 6 hours from Boston, 5 hours from Toronto. Because the rest of the country doesn't have fiber connections into homes and businesses yet, he feels intensely the remoteness of Corning. Mazzali brought me a cup of steaming coffee. As I drank, he said emphatically, "When you think about glass, some people say, 'Oh, I get sand and I melt that and then I make glass.' Of course, it's much more sophisticated than that for optical fiber. It's totally different. Fiber-optic cable is made completely synthetically. It has to be so pure, so clear, that it can transmit light over many dozens of miles without any boosting or encouragement, and without losing any of the information that has been encoded onto that light. To get that clarity, its manufacturers control every micron in every second of the manufacturing process." The history of fiber optics goes back to the 1960s with the invention of the laser. Lasers apply energy to billions of atoms, exciting their electrons and making them emit photons that then turn around and make already excited atoms give off even more photons. When some of the photons are allowed to escape, the result is an amplified, concentrated beam of light, light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation, or laser. That light has a frequency. It is wobbling at a rate of millions of times a second, and each of those wobbles can be modulated to carry data. That data then travels at the speed of light. The trouble was how to transmit that focused data reliably from point A to point B. Light can be carried by water. Just imagine a nighttime fountain lit by purple light from below. But light can't carry information through water very far. You need the waves to maintain their strength and definition in order for the information they carry, encoded in the height or frequency of these waves, to be understood. Back in the late 19th century, a Viennese medical team identified only as Dr. Roth and Professor Roos experimented with guiding light through bent glass rods to illuminate body parts during surgery. With the arrival of the laser, scientists saw the possibility of guiding information across many miles with very little loss of accuracy. Enter optical fiber. Researcher Charles Cow, now Sir Cow, while a PhD student in Harlow, England in 1964, posited that glass, a later generation of the glass tubes that had been used to illuminate surgery, could be used to guide many colors or frequencies of laser beams. But Cal pointed out that for this guidance to occur without significant loss, the glass had to be much purer than anything then available. His work was purely theoretical. His work got Corning interested in the idea of optical fiber. In 1965, Corning was in the glass business, but not the telecommunications business. Telecommunications companies were using copper lines to transmit the electrical pulses that carry voice calls and data between cities and into homes. To make it worthwhile for those companies, a potentially huge new group of customers, to replace their copper lines with fiber, Corning would have to show that fiber was so much better at conveying data than copper that it would be worthwhile for those customers to replace their existing copper lines. But at the time, there was no glass strand that could transmit light more than about 15 centimeters before the signal fell off or was lost or attenuated. Corning needed to figure out how to create glass that could transmit a signal not for centimeters, but for many miles. The head of Corning Glassworks research at the time, William Armistead, was skeptical. Nevertheless, he approved funding for Robert Maurer, a physicist, as well as colleagues Pete Schultz, a senior chemist, and Donald Keck, an engineer and physicist, to work on the problem. And they did, without a customer in sight. Maurer and his team knew that the glass would have to have a clear core surrounded by a skin called cladding, and also made of glass, so that the cladding could reflect laser light back into the core and keep it traveling along its path. For 4 years, he and his team at Corning kept experimenting with different chemical compositions of the core to create the greatest possible clarity. Failure followed failure. One Friday evening in August 1970, Donald Keck was alone in the Corning R&D lab, testing one last piece of fiber before the weekend. Ira Magaziner and Mark Patinkin, in their book, The Silent War, tell the story of Keck bending over his microscope and lining up the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.